morning, just a couple of announcements I want to bring your attention. You'll notice on the back counter back there, there's a couple of things that are there. You'll see these prayer journals. They're kind of devotional prayer journals. They have a devotion in them for each day of the week they are intended. We're going to begin these on Easter Sunday. And then we'll go through to Pentecost Sunday. We're praying for God to bring renewal and revival in our lives personally, in the life of our community, in the life of our country. So you can pick one up. It begins there on Easter Sunday. It's the first day, and then we're going to carry it all the way through 50 days to Pentecost. And so I'd encourage you to pick one of these up. You'll hear more about that a little bit later. Also, if you haven't had the opportunity, there is a church directory in the back. And so you can feel free to pick one of those up. If you see there's not one back there and they've all been taken, let me know. We'll print more. We've already printed, I think, 30. So we'll have those available to you. On the side table over here, there's a little card that looks like this. You'll see it on the bulletin boards. This is for House of Promise. They're having a concert at 2 o'clock in the afternoon on Palm Sunday. That's the 2nd of April. The group that is singing is called Rejoice. And so you'll see the information there. You can look on the card or look at the website for House of Promise, and they'll give you that information that is there. Now to the bulletin. You say you got all kinds of stuff today. Our mission area revival begins March 26th through the 29th. That's at the Palisade Church of the Nazarene. You'll see the address there. It starts 6 o'clock on Sunday night, the 26th, and then Monday through Wednesday, 7 o'clock. Dr. Jim Deal is going to be our evangelist. He is a tremendous preacher of the word. I mean, one thing I can say, you may get bored when I preach, but you're not going to get bored when Jim preaches. He's just a powerful preacher, and you'll just enjoy that. So we're doing the worship on Monday and Tuesday. Grand Junction Church is doing it on Sunday and Wednesday. So just plan to go take an evening and enjoy a time of revival with the other churches across our mission area. Then also on Palm Sunday, we are having a showing of the movie No Vacancy. The story there is about a reporter who is devoted to a rural news station but covers a church where a recovering addict is involved with the church to help transform an old motel into housing for homeless families. And so it's a tremendous story of the work of God, not only in the life of the reporter, in the life of the recovering addict, but also in the life of the church. And so it, in some ways, has a little bit of connection to kind of what God's been doing among us. And so that's on Palm Sunday, April 2nd, 6 o'clock. Also, it's going to be a fellowship afterwards, so bring some food to share. So we'll watch the film together, and then we're going to go sit around the table and enjoy some good food. So I invite you to do that as well. Then Easter's coming up. That's on April the 9th. We're going to have our Easter brunch at 9 o'clock in the morning, followed by our Easter worship service at 10. There is a sign-up sheet on the back counter for you to sign up for items for brunch, breakfast, casseroles, fruit, that kind of thing. Again, just an opportunity to gather together before we celebrate the resurrection of Jesus. And so I encourage you to take note of that. A couple things that you don't have written down in your bulletin. One is, because Easter's coming up on the 9th, we want to get ourselves ready to prepare for Easter. And so we're having a work day here at the church on the 2nd. That's on Palm Sunday. Palm Sunday's going to be a busy day. Saturday. If you show up on church on Sunday, you don't have to work. But if you show up on Saturday, we're going to have a work day, going to clean up the yard, kind of clean up the inside of the church, getting ready to celebrate Easter. So that's at 10 o'clock on April the 1st. That's not an April Fool's joke, April the 1st, 10 o'clock here at the church for a cleanup and work day. Also, we're needing to expand some workers into the nursery. We have a toddler class that meets. We have a youth class and a children's class. Now we need a nursery class. We have babies. I can see right back there. Little Elias is back there. So we need some people to volunteer to serve in the nursery. So if you're interested in that, if you'll see me or if you'll see my wife, we'll get that coordinated for the nursery. Now, along with that, to keep with the baby thing, we have new babies in the life. Congratulations to Daryl and Mary and Tim and Trish on the birth of Flint Ray. Okay, I'll get it right. I'm losing track of your grandkids, sorry. There's so many of them. So they just born on Tuesday, and so we praise the Lord for that. Also, Daryl and Mary have new grandson twins born to Janelle and Jared Dupre. And Ethan, thank you. I wanted to say Elton John, but I'm not coming. It's Ethan John. And then Grayson Ray, is that correct? Okay, Grayson Ray. And that's Jared and Jill. So all kinds of babies around here. So we praise the Lord for God's walking each of these parents through. And now we continue to pray for them and also the babies that are present in our church as well. God will help their parents as they raise them up in the nurture and the admonition of the Lord. So let's continue to pray for them as well. At this time now, we have a graduation. Mario is graduating from Calvary Ranch, Colorado. And so he's going to come and share his testimony with us. So Mario, come on up.
On you.
Hi, everybody.
Good morning.
This is definitely a big fear of mine, talking in front of this many people. I don't really know how to put into words what I've received in coming here. I spent most of my life in Shriners Hospital growing up, and I was raised by my mother. She did a lot for me growing up, and as I grew up, I was always on some kind of pain medication, and it kind of grew out of hand as I got older. In middle school and high school, I started abusing it a lot. I started doing a lot of things that I shouldn't have done. And I've lived my life in a lot of regret for some of the things that I have done. As I got older, I met a woman who I loved incredibly. I mean, I don't think I've ever known love until I felt the love from her. And I did a lot of really bad things, and I lost her because of it. And when I lost her, I completely kind of threw in the towel, and the guy that I became, I was not proud of. Pretty much every sin you can think of, for the most part, I've partaken in. And I never knew Jesus or the Bible or really any kind of spirituality that wasn't of my own imagination. And I was actually really against it. Through reading the Bible, I can't remember his name, but he persecuted Christianity and the people of Christianity, and that really aligned with me because I saw so much, I guess, perfection, and I was just jealous in what people had, and I was not willing to hear it. I was not willing to learn about it. And my story in getting to here was something that I can't explain without God. I've been in so many rehabs and psych wards, it's impossible to count. And I was done with it. I was done with the way that society tried to fix me. And I was just gonna go be a hermit. It was kind of my idea. I didn't really have a plan. I just was gonna drive my truck into the mountains, set up camp, and see what happened. And I was very okay with not coming back. And my mother, the day before I left, she's also just like me. She didn't have a grasp on spirituality or Christianity, and she had bought a Bible about a week before. And
Spirit, that you'd anoint him and empower him to be your witness. That, Lord, he would sense your great love, Lord, for perfect love cast out fear. We thank you for that. We saw that this morning. We just praise your name. Now bless him, Lord, we pray. Use him for your glory and to your praise in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
We have a new brother
who's going to come in today, Brother Justin, and so we're going to pray for him. So, Brother Justin, would you just come? And again, we're just thankful for God's grace, Lord. Heavenly Father, we thank you for Justin and his beginning of this journey, Lord. Mario has graduated, is heading out on the new journey, Lord, but Justin's coming in. And we just pray, Lord Jesus, your Spirit would move in his heart and his life. You give him victory over the things with which he struggles. And, Lord, you give him hope. Lord, you are the God of hope, and we thank you for that. Now, be with Brother Justin as he enters. Lord, may your grace and your peace and your Spirit fill him to become all that you created and redeemed him to be. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Welcome. God is good. All the time. Amen. We're so glad what God does in the lives of people. And that's really why we gather together. A church is not about a bunch of perfect people showing up to say how good we are. It's about a bunch of us that need Jesus. And because we need Jesus, we come and worship him and look what God does in the lives. So let's worship the Lord this morning. Let's stand together and prepare our hearts this morning. Heavenly Father, thank you for your grace and for your mercy. Thank you for your love. Lord, we just pray as we worship you today that you draw our spirits into your presence, that you would just help us to get to be thankful and grateful for all that you've done in our lives. And to bring glory to your name. Lord, we just praise you today in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's sing together.
I was once a sinner, but I came, pardon to receive from my Lord. This was freely given.
Worship him. He helps to be able to not only see Jesus on the church on Sunday morning, but on Monday afternoon and Thursday, and in the nights that are dark and difficult, Jesus is present, and he opens the eyes of our hearts so we can see him. Someone else and lifting them up before the Lord. These altars are open during our time of prayer, for it's just as it would come before the Lord. Let's prepare to pray. Victory and overcoming in Jesus' name. But Lord, we pray today that you would continue to shape us into the image of Jesus, that we would be like him. That Lord, you would transform our mind. Lord, that we might be able to test and approve your good, pleasing, and perfect will. That you transform our heart, oh God, give us a clean heart and renew a right spirit within us. Lord, just help us to live lives that are shaped and molded by the Spirit of God into the image of Jesus. Lord, that's our prayer today. And Lord, we know that there are places in our lives that are not quite there yet. We understand that. But Lord, we ask you continually, renew us in the image of Jesus. And Lord, we pray today for these physical needs. We're thankful for these new babies, Lord. We just pray, Lord, for these new young ones, Lord. We pray for Flint, Lord, and we pray for Ethan. We pray for Grayson. Lord, we just ask, Lord Jesus, today that you would just touch these little childs, this little life. Lord, we pray that they would grow up in the nurture and the admonition of the Lord. We pray for their parents as they raise them, Lord, that you'd give them just the words to say and the way of leading them, Lord, that when it comes a point in time in their life, when they recognize their need for you, that, Lord, they'd come to know you as Savior and live lives that honor you. Lord, we just are thankful today, Lord, not only for these, but for the other families and children in the church. Lord, we just pray that they would all just see you, and Lord, when they come to that age of accountability, that, Lord, they would come as believers in Jesus Christ. Lord, we pray today for these that need your healing. Lord, you see the names that are listed here. Lord, we pray for Donna and Judy and for Judy Marcillo, for Paul's father. We pray, Lord, for Larry Chavacek, Daryl Gilks, Anna Leah, Chris, Olivia, Dawn, Bob, Kirsten, Laura, Phil, Chrissy, Dwayne, Bertha, Arlene, Darlene's father, and Carrie Pitt. Lord, we lift all of these names up. Lord, you know their needs, and we pray, Jesus, that your healing grace would be theirs. Lord, you're the great physician, and so we commit them to you today. Lord, we also thank you for the ranch, and we pray for Tim and for the brothers. Again, we thank you for what you're doing in their midst, what you're doing in our midst, Lord, as you continue to bring renewal and hope to the lives of men who are struggling with difficult situations. Lord, we just pray today for victory, for hope, for perseverance. Lord, may you just continue to work in their lives. Lord, we pray for a house of promise as well for the ladies as you work in their lives there. And we just pray, Lord, for you to bring renewal and hope in their lives as well. Lord, we live in a broken world, and we need you. Without you, Lord, we can do nothing. But Lord, with you, we can do all things through Christ who strengthens us. So help us this day, Lord, to continue to lean into you and to allow you to renew our hearts and our lives. Lord, that's our prayer today in Jesus' name. Amen. At this time now, we're going to dismiss our children and our youth for their children and youth classes. And so let them feel free to be dismissed. As they are going, we invite our ushers to come forward so we can receive this morning's tithes and offering. We are preparing today for our Easter offering, almost at Thanksgiving, our Easter offering that's coming up on April the 9th. We are looking to raise $1,000 to help carry the gospel of Jesus Christ around the world. And Brother Byron, would you help Brother Christopher this morning? morning. I received the offering. It looks like those two plates were a little heavy for him this morning. So we want to make sure that we receive God's grace. We not only care for the gospel here in Montrose, but in Colorado and around the world. And so we just pray that God would help us. So if God leads you, I'm not a person who says you need to do such and such an amount. I just simply say, do what the Lord leads you to do. And when the Lord leads you to do it, God always seems to meet that need. Let's pray together. Father, bless this offering. Bless the gifts and the givers as well. And Lord, may you just continue to use us to accomplish your purpose of making Christ-like disciples in the nations. We pray for that today in Jesus' name. Amen.
Church.
Good morning.
I thank God for my salvation. I just wanted to share with you before Flint was born. You know, Trish and I lost a child 7 years back, a baby. It was a very hard thing. So as I was praying that night, that's where my prayer started. You know, God, please make this baby healthy and all the rest of that. But it wasn't until I just looked at God's glory in my prayers and the miracle of the childbirth that I could worship my King and how he set the example. I don't think there's a older miracle that we can see on this earth. I don't think there's anything greater than birth of a child. You know, we see God's creation, how he set it all up. And when I got to that point in my prayers, it was just glory to God. It was probably the most beautiful night I had a prayer in my entire life. You know, it started out I said, sorry about that. But anyways, 1 Samuel 16, 1 through 13. The Lord said to Samuel, how long will you mourn for Saul, since I have rejected him as king over Israel? Fill your horn with oil and be on your way. I am sending you to Jesse of Bethlehem. I have chosen one of his sons to be king. But Samuel said, how can I go? Saul will hear about it and kill me. The Lord said, take a heifer with you and say, I have come to sacrifice to the Lord. Invite Jesse to the sacrifice and I will show you what to do. You are to anoint for me the one I indicate. Samuel did what the Lord said. When he arrived at Bethlehem, the elders of the town trembled when they met him. They asked, do you come in peace? Samuel replied, yes, in peace. I have come to sacrifice to the Lord. Consecrate yourselves and come to the sacrifice with me. Then he consecrated Jesse and his sons and invited them to the sacrifice. When they arrived, Samuel saw
brought with me today this bottle of Mountain Dew. That's what I use this process. I want to do something today and just kind of, you know. I heard that. Don't point it at me. You see, when you do this, you see what happens when you shake that up? All kinds of energy and pressure is kind of built up in here. Now, I could do this and just do that. I think Byron's coming to me. I won't do that. But what would happen if I did that? You know, it goes spewing everywhere. It would just gush out to wherever the pressure would push it towards. Now, I did that this morning to kind of put in your mind this thought process. God's love is ever gushing out towards you. His love is ever seeking you. It's ever reaching out to you. His love is so great that he's just compelled to love you. So today I want us to think about that love of God. That love in which we are the object of his love, in which he as creator not only created us, but when we fell into sin, he redeemed us through the blood of Jesus because of his great love for us. And so today, I'm going to read a scripture. I did not put the scripture up on the screen today, but I want you to take your Bibles, if you happen to turn to the book of John, the third chapter. You're going to be pretty familiar with this passage of scripture today. But I want you to listen to the story that we have here that Jesus tells about an encounter he had with a man with the name of Nicodemus. Begins in verse 1 of John chapter 3. Now there was a Pharisee, a man named Nicodemus, who was a member of the Jewish ruling council. He came to Jesus at night and said, "Rabbi, we know that you're a teacher who has come from God, for no one could perform the signs you were doing if God were not with him." Jesus replied, "Very truly, I tell you, no one can see the kingdom of God unless they are born again. Now how can someone be born when they are old?" Nicodemus asked. "Surely they cannot enter a second time into their mother's womb to be born." You know, we just had birth, and so we're taking that process. That's where Nicodemus was. Jesus said, answered, "Very truly, I tell you, no one can enter the kingdom of God unless they are born of water and the Spirit. Flesh gives birth to flesh, but the Spirit gives birth to the Spirit. You should not be surprised at my saying you must be born again. The wind blows wherever it pleases. You hear its sound, but you cannot tell where it comes from or where it's going. So it is with those born of the Spirit." "How can this be?" Nicodemus asked. "You're Israel's teacher," said Jesus, "and you do not understand these things. Very truly, I tell you, we speak of what we know and we testify to what we have seen, but still you people do not accept our testimony. I have spoken to you of earthly things, and you do not believe. How then will you believe if I speak of heavenly things? No one has ever gone into heaven except the one who came from heaven, the Son of Man. Just as Moses lifted up the snake in the wilderness, so the Son of Man must be lifted up, that everyone who believes may have eternal life in him. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish but have eternal life. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but to save the world through him. Whoever believes in him is not condemned, and whoever does not believe stands condemned already because they've not believed in the name of God's one and only Son. This is the verdict. Light has come into the world, but people love darkness instead of light because their deeds were evil. Everyone who does evil hates the light and will not come into the light for fear that their deeds will be exposed. But whoever lives by the truth comes into the light, so that it may be plainly seen that what they have done has been done in the sight of God." Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your word today. We thank you for the grace that you give us, Lord. We're thankful that you love us so much. You just literally reach out to us in passion and in love to redeem us and to bring us back into relationship with you. Lord, I pray today, as we open your word, that your Spirit would speak to our souls. In Jesus' name. So Nicodemus was a Pharisee. Now as we talk about sometimes the Bible, sometimes we give the Pharisees a bad rap. They were the people of God in that day. They were into the Word. They studied God's law. The problem was they missed Jesus. Many of them were so into God's law and his rules and his regulations that they missed the relationship that God wanted to have with them. Now Nicodemus came to Jesus at night. Now we don't know exactly why he came at night. Perhaps he was afraid of being seen by other Pharisees, connecting with this man Jesus. Because a lot of times the Pharisees would come to him with gotcha questions. You know what I mean? Questions set up to kind of be a trap so that you give the answer they want you to give so they can just jump on you. Now, we don't do that today, do we? We don't have gotcha questions that we go to people with and say, I'm going to ask you this question so you give the answer so I can just kind of jump on you. Now, we might do that on Facebook or social media. You see, God never comes to us with gotcha questions. He's not trying to trick us or to trap us or to do something. He comes to us out of love. And yet here these Pharisees were a lot of times coming to Jesus with these gotcha questions, but that wasn't Nicodemus. Nicodemus was either sincere in his faith or simply needed to know more about Jesus. So he went at night and Jesus welcomed him. And we have this conversation in John chapter 3. First thing I want us to notice tonight is that in Christ we are born anew. We need to understand that when we come to Jesus and he does a work in our life, he starts something brand new. Notice the questions here. Nicodemus says, no one can perform the signs you're doing if God were not with him. In other words, he recognized the work of God in Jesus' life. He can see when God touched people and brought healing. He can see the renewal in the life of the Spirit around him. Nicodemus was genuinely interested in Jesus. Let me ask you, maybe that's you today. Maybe you're not sure about this Jesus thing, but you're genuinely interested. You see what he's done in other people's lives. You've heard the testimony like we heard this morning. You've seen the lives of people being lived out who were once walking in darkness and now walking in light. And so he said, there is something about this Jesus that just is intriguing to me. And so that may be where Nicodemus was. And then Jesus says, no one can see the kingdom of God unless they're born. The translation there means literally born again or born anew. But Nicodemus didn't quite get it. Now we understand that. We have 1,000 years of teaching. We've seen God at work. But Nicodemus was in the hospital, kind of like Tim and Daryl were. And he was in the hospital going, this doesn't make sense. When the baby comes, you don't go back in and do it again. It's not a repeat job. And so he's trying in his mind to figure this all out. John 3:4 says, how can someone be born when they are old? Surely they cannot enter a second time into their mother's womb to be born. But Jesus meant something different. He used this translation as anew, a rebirth by the Holy Spirit of God. Jesus said, no one can enter the kingdom of God unless they're born of water and the Spirit. Jesus said there is something spiritual that goes on that's also recognized by something that we do outside. Water here is a reference to baptism and the new birth. You see, when we're becoming Christian and follow Jesus Christ, we make a decision to walk with him. And he does something on the inside of us. You see, it's not what we do. It's not that we somehow passed the test or came up with a certain set of rules that we follow because we do these things, we're Christians. No, Jesus does a work in us in which he forgives our sins and creates new life in us. The scripture says that he who has the Son has life. And so there's something that takes place. When we come to Jesus, he works on the inside of us and creates new life in us. Then, something that we do is the tradition of church, we go to baptism. And baptism is a place where we testify to what God has already done. And he begins to do this work in us. And so it's a focus on the crucified, resurrected Jesus. And our life begins to start to look like the life of Jesus. And we are daily crucified, picking up our cross, following him, and being daily transformed into the image of Jesus. Nicodemus says, this doesn't make sense to me. Now, can you imagine? Here's Jesus who can explain this perfectly, and here's Nicodemus who's not getting it. He's a man of God. He's studied the word. He's a Pharisee. He's probably a ruler of the Pharisees. He's got a professorship and a doctorate. I'm facetiously saying that today. He knows everything there is to know, but he's missing the point. The point is, we can know everything there is to know about God's word, about the scriptures, and miss out on Jesus. It's the relationship of Jesus and the transforming work of Jesus. How is it that we can be born anew? Not doctrinally, not just a way of thinking, but in reality in our life. How are we born anew? So Jesus says, I'm going to give him an illustration to help him understand that God loves this God-hating world. You see, God loves us even though we were separated from him. He says, here's the illustration, John 3, verses 14 and 15. Just as Moses lifted up the snake in the wilderness, so the Son of Man must be lifted up, that everyone who believes may have eternal life in him. Now, Jesus knew that Nicodemus would know this story. This comes out of the Exodus when the people of Israel are going through the wilderness and they rebelled. That's the best way to put it. They rebelled, and as part of that rebellion, there was a judgment with poisonous snakes were killing Israelites as a result of God's judgment for their sinful complaining. Now, I want to take just a second. Do not raise your hands. How many of us like to complain? Okay? Israel was being judged for complaining. In Numbers chapter 21, verses 5 and 6, but the people grew impatient on the way. Well, he had to use that word patience, didn't he? But the people grew impatient on the way. They spoke against God and against Moses and said, why have you brought us out of Egypt to die in the wilderness? There is no bread. There's no water. We detest this miserable food, the manna that God was giving them every day so they could survive. And then the Lord sent venomous snakes among them that bit the people, and many Israelites died. Now, if that's not a warning against complaining, I don't know what is. Now, I don't see any snakes crawling around here today. If I'm out in the country and I'm walking and hiking, I might see a rattlesnake. I'm paying attention. I want to make sure I don't kick over rocks and stuff. But Israel was being judged for their disbelief and their complaining against God. God had brought them out of Egypt, out of slavery. God had brought them into the wilderness, and he gave them water to drink. He gave them food to eat. Every single morning they could go out and collect this manna that just appeared in the desert, and they collected that, and that helped them to live. And they were complaining against God's provision. Lord, help us. Because I'm guilty of that at times. I don't maybe like the way God served up my provision. I wanted steak, and he gave me chicken. I wanted to have something well-cooked and nice, and he gave me a cheese sandwich and macaroni. You know, sometimes we got to be careful to be thankful for the blessing of God and not complaining about what God didn't do. You understand what I'm saying? We can be very, very blessed and not even realize it. However, the people recognized what was happening, and they repented of their sin. And so Moses prayed for them. We see this in Numbers 21, 7 through 9. It says, the people came to Moses and said, we sinned when we spoke against the Lord and against you. Pray that the Lord will take the snakes away from us. So Moses prayed for the people. The Lord said to Moses, make a snake and put it up on a pole. Anyone who is bitten can look at it and live. So Moses made a bronze snake, put it up on a pole. And when the animal was bitten by a snake, they looked at the bronze snake, and they lived. That's the story that Nicodemus is now going to hear from Jesus. He said, when they was in the desert and they had sinned, they repented of their sin. And so Moses prayed for them and they made a snake and they looked at the snake and they were saved from the consequences of their rebellion. I want you to follow with me. They were saved from the consequences of their rebellion. And then Jesus says, here's what I want you to see in John 12:32. And when I am lifted up from the earth, will draw all people to myself. Jesus says, I'm the snake on the cross, on the pole. I'm going to be lifted up on a cross, and I'm going to bear the sin of the world. And that sin, if you will look to me on the cross, if you will see me on the cross, and you will repent of your sin and your rebellion as the Israelites did that then, and you believe in me as the Son of God, I will wash away your sins and I will save your soul. He says, Nicodemus, you didn't get it when I said born again, but here's what I'm telling you. If you remember that snake, I'm in that place. And Jesus is in that place today where he died on the cross for you and me. Our sins can be forgiven by looking at Jesus the Christ. Our sins can be washed away, never to be remembered against us again. Praise the Lord. We don't have to die in our rebellion. There were those in Israel who were rebelling and complaining against God, and they died in their rebellion because they didn't look to God's provision. And there are people today who are dying in their rebellion against God because they haven't looked to God's provision in the person of Jesus Christ. Jesus the Christ is our provision for the forgiveness of our sins, for the entrance of eternal life into our lives, for the power to live a life that looks like Jesus Christ. He is the provision if we look to Him. When I'm lifted up, I'll draw all men to myself. It says in John 3:16, for God so loved the world that He gave His one and only Son, that whoever believes in Him should not perish, but have eternal life. That's for you. That's God's love pouring out to you. You see, He could have rebelled. He could have said, well, they're just a bunch of rebellious people. Remember how He talked about the people of Israel being stiff-necked people? You know, they never want to do what's right. He could have said, I'm just going to do away with them. But no, He loves us so much that He sent His one and only Son, that our sins can be forgiven, and we can have a relationship with the living God through the person of Jesus Christ. And you know what? He's already doing that work in your life. When He says, I will draw all people to myself, John 12:32, He's using a Greek word here which literally means to drag or to pull. We in the Church of Nazarene use a term called prevenient grace, the grace that comes before. It talks about convicting and drawing work of the Holy Spirit that pulls us to relationship with Jesus. Before I came to know Jesus, God was already at work in my life. Before I ever made a decision to walk with Him and become a disciple of Him, the Holy Spirit was already in my life, setting things up, pointing me to Jesus. I've told this story before, but it fits right in this place. My parents bought a set of encyclopedias, and I can't remember whether they were Seventh-day Adventists or Jehovah's Witnesses. I don't remember who it was selling them, but they bought them. They probably bought them to get rid of the person that was selling them. You know what I mean? They really could care less what was in the books. They just said, hey, I'll buy them if you'll leave. So they bought them. But they sat around our house, and one of the things I liked to do when I was a child was read encyclopedias. I know I'm a geek. And I read social studies books, which helped me in school. But I read these books, and they had pictures of the second coming of Jesus, and they had pictures of people who were burning in hell. They had pictures of the rapture and all those kind of things in there. And I, fifth grader, sixth grader, I didn't have a clue what was going on, but I was reading these things. But God, the Holy Spirit, began to talk to me. He began to work in my heart. I didn't know who Jesus was. We weren't going to church. We weren't church-going people. But there was something about this. And so I began to read this, and I dreamed one night that the Lord came back in the rapture. And everybody else is going up, but I'm not. And I'm trying to jump. I'm trying to be, you know, Michael Jordan, seeing how high I if I just get up here and grab hold of somebody's ankle on the way up, maybe they'll pull me. You know, that's just what was happening. Finally, one day, at a youth camp, the Holy Spirit of God said, you know, I've been talking to you for a while. Do you want to follow me? Do you want to become a Christian? And I went down to an altar, sort of like this, at a youth camp and said, yes, Jesus, I want to be a follower of you. And He changed my heart. He changed my life. He made me different because He was working in my life. You may be saying, well, sometimes I'm not sure about all this Christian stuff, but I sure do run across people and talk to them about Jesus. And I see what God's doing in somebody else's life. And I watch all of that, and I said, maybe this Jesus is real. Maybe He can make a difference in my life like He's made a difference in Autumn's life or other people's life. He can make a difference in me. That's the Holy Spirit. So sometimes when God brings up in our life things that are sinful, it's not because He hates us. It's because He loves us. And He wants to show us that so we can have that cleansed and forgiven and done away with so we can know really what it means to walk with Jesus. Conviction is good. Conviction is when God reveals to us and convinces us that what's happening is not right. But He points us to the cross of Jesus. He points us to the remedy for that. He says, but if you confess your sin, I'm faithful and just to forgive us your sin and to cleanse you from all unrighteousness. It will simply bring it to Him. He will cleanse it and wash away. God intended that we might know Christ. He loved this God-hating world. We were once enemies of God, but now we've come to Christ. That brings me to my third thing this morning, and that is this. And I know I'm jumping over some scriptures back to Dave, I apologize. Jesus came to save the world and not condemn it. He came to save the world and not condemn it. Verse 17, for God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but to save the world through him. Nicodemus was a Pharisee, and the Pharisee's attitude was not to save the world, but to condemn the world. Pharisees are really good at pointing out your sin. You know what I mean? You know, if you just didn't do this, they have a list of rules, and they point out everything that's bad, and they tell you why you're not a good Christian, and they do all these things. Now, their goal is not like Jesus. Jesus says, I'm going to convict you of your sin so I can forgive your sin and cleanse you. The Pharisees say, well, I'm just going to point out your sin because you're bad. You know, and I just want to tell you how much better I am than you, so I'm going to point out your sin. Nicodemus was a Pharisee, but he's struggling with the decision. Jesus said, I love you, and I want to save you, and to heal you, and to restore you, and give you new life. I want to back up to Colossians. I don't know if Dave can do this, but listen to the scripture if you can. Colossians 1, 21 to 22. Once you were alienated from God and were enemies in your minds because of your evil behavior. But now he has reconciled you by Christ's physical body through death to present you holy in his sight without blemish and free from accusation. You see, the Pharisees were accusing. But they had no answer. You're just bad. Just do better. Keep those rules. Keep living right. Jesus said, I want to reconcile you by my body to present you without blemish and free from accusation. You know who the accuser is? That's Satan. You see, Jesus will convict you of your sin, but he'll give you the grace and forgiveness of having it forgiven. The accuser says, you're just a bad person. Remember we talked last week about shame? You know, guilt is when we know we've done something wrong, but shame is when we think we're the bad thing. God doesn't shame us. He convicts us so we can forgive our sin. But the accuser wants to alienate us from God, and therefore he says and just accuses us. That's not Jesus. Jesus wants to change us and transform us and give us a new heart. Here, Ezekiel 36, verses 26 and 27. I will give you a new heart and put a new spirit in you. I'll remove from you your heart of stone and give you a heart of flesh. And I'll put my spirit in you and move you to follow my decrees and be careful to keep my laws. What is he doing? He says, I'm not telling you what to do. I'm going to change you so you can. It's one thing to see a list of rules and have to try to figure it out for yourself. It's another thing to know that he gives you a heart that wants to do what is right, that wants to live what is right, and changes you on the inside. He says, create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me. That's why I pray that way. It's an internal transformation and change. He changes our heart so we want to be like Jesus. He changes our hearts so we want to live like Christ. We want to read the Word. We want to become what the Word teaches because he's changed us on the inside. We will never be right with God with exterior rules. We'll only be right with God when he changes us inside and makes us a different person. He who has the Son of God has life. That's my prayer for you this morning. That you'd recognize how much God loves you. That you would let him come and wash away your sin and look to the cross of Christ where he has placed himself there as the redemption for your sin, as the forgiveness of your sins. Let him come into your life and give you new birth. And then to set you free. Now I want to just add something real quick today. If you're interested in being baptized to testify to that decision, we want to have a baptismal service on Easter Sunday. And maybe you've not had that chance to just testify to Jesus through the waters of baptism. It says this in 1 Peter 3. This water symbolizes baptism that now saves you also, not the removal of dirt from your body, but the pledge of a clear conscience towards God. It saves you by the resurrection of Jesus Christ, who has gone into heaven and is at God's right hand with angels, authorities, and powers in submission to him. Jesus wants to save you. That's the inner work. And then we, by faith, go through baptism, testifying this is what God has done. As I tell the whole world around me, God has washed my sins away. We have a phrase that we use in baptism. It says, buried in the likeness of his death, raised in the power of his resurrection. Think about that. Jesus died, and we go be buried in his death. But you know why we celebrate Easter? Because on Easter Sunday, God raised Jesus from the dead. And now he sits at the right hand of God. And in our lives personally, we can have our sins forgiven and be raised in newness of life to become a person who then is changed on the inside that lives like Jesus on the outside because of what he's done. Praise the Lord this morning. I want to read a prayer for you to close up this morning in the very last slide, Dave. It says, Lord, your word says that you'll give us a new heart. It says that you'll give us the heart of flesh and put a new spirit in us. We want that. Take our old heart of stone and throw it away and replace it with a heart of self-giving love that looks like yours. That's our prayer today. That's what God wants to do. He wants to make us new in him by taking that old flesh out and filling us up with that new heart that looks like Jesus. My question this morning for you is this. Has God done that in your life? Have you allowed him to give you new birth? We celebrate about these new babies being born. And the new life and the miracle that is, thank you for that testimony, Tim. But there is a tremendous miracle that comes when God not only gives us birth physically, but he gives us new birth spiritually in the name of Jesus Christ. And that's what he wants for you today. He wants for all of us. Not because somehow we're good people, but because we're not good enough, we need Jesus. And we look to the cross and we find his grace and his forgiveness. Let's stand together this morning. Heavenly Father, I pray today that you'd give us new life. Lord, maybe there's someone here today that just needs to know you. They've heard about you. They've seen you in somebody else's life. The Holy Spirit has begun drawing them to you, but they've not made that decision to be a follower of Jesus Christ, to be a Christian. Lord, I pray today that they would pray that prayer, that you give them a new heart, that you'd forgive their sin. But if we confess our sin, you're faithful to forgive us our sin and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Lord, I pray that they would do that today. And then, Lord, that they would testify and live out a life that looks like you. Lord, change your heart. Make it new. That's our prayer today. In Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. We're going to sing a closing song this morning. It's simply said, we sang it for the prayer for us. Change my heart, O God, make it ever true. If that's your prayer this morning, you want to come and just ask God to give you a new heart and invite you to come and kneel here at this altar. You're not joining our church. You're simply saying, I want to follow Jesus the Christ. I want to be a Christian. I don't want him to change my heart on the inside so I can live like him on the outside. If that's you, we'd invite you to come and pray as we sing together. Let's sing. Look more like Jesus, we need to grab a hold of that. But it will never happen unless God changes our heart. It'll never happen unless we let Him renew us on the inside. And I don't know what decision you make, Dave. There's probably a couple of people sitting on your shoulder right now. There's the Holy Spirit that says that's exactly what you need. You need for God to change your life. And you're worried about what people are thinking. Don't worry about that. Just listen to Jesus. But there's also the accuser that's sitting on your shoulder. And he says, that's never for you. You've done too much bad stuff. You're too bad of a person. God can never forgive what you've done. Scripture says that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us and went to the cross, shed his own blood that our sin might be forgiven. While we were yet sinners, he didn't say fix up your life and then come to Jesus. He said come to Jesus and Jesus will help you fix up your life. Come to Jesus and let him begin that new work in you. We're going to sing this one more time, then we're going to close in prayer. But if that argument's going on in your head, if there's the Spirit of God, the accuser trying to argue that point out, just tell the devil to get behind you and be obedient to Jesus and let him create a new heart in you. Let's sing it together. This morning, there's a Bible study. We're studying the book of Matthew 5 and 6. If you want to join us back in the fellowship hall, if you're interested in being baptized, we will give testimony to that. If you'll let me know, just come talk to me.